heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength.
There they are, stand.
I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. With all my heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength.
Take a moment and say hi to somebody around.
And with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength.
You can be seated. We want to welcome you this morning. We're glad you're here. And ready to worship with us. At least we hope you're ready to worship with us, because we're going to worship up here. We hope that you'll come along and worship with us. Let's start out by offering a word of prayer to our Lord and Savior. God, thank you so much for your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the example that he sets for us, teaching us to love you, Lord, with all of our heart and soul and mind and strength. And we know, Lord, that that's not just an empty type of love, that we love because you first loved us. You loved us with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. And we thank you for that salvation that comes through Jesus Christ. And we just praise you in his name. Amen.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Find me, all my fears and failures. come fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine your light, Lord. Shine it through us.
Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
Have his salvation through Jesus Christ. And when he tells us things in scripture like, you want to serve the Lord, do it by loving him with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. And what we understand is that he has provided a means for our salvation. He is worthy of such praise. But even before any of us were born, even before this world was spoken into creation, God's greatness was already in display.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, we'll see how praise.
If you want to grab your journals, we're going to be in Mark chapter 12 and beginning in verse 28. Mark chapter 12, verse 28. I know I say this every week, but it's, you know, maybe beneficial to somebody. We're picking up right where we left off last week. So we continue this journey through the Gospel of Mark. I was thinking about, you know, this outline quite a bit, and I changed it over and over again for this message, for this text today. And I told Dave, I said, you know, the simple outline is this. Somebody asked Jesus a question. Jesus answered the question, and all the people went, wow. And we kind of have had that. Like, that seems to be the pattern. That seems to be the theme. And so today, I ended up just kind of digging into it a little bit deeper from a different angle and drawing some questions out that are actually going to be our principles and our outline for today. But questions, I think, are very powerful. They cause you to probe deep in your heart and deep in your mind and deep in your priorities and cause you to think about some things that maybe you haven't thought about, you should think about. The very first Sunday that Craig and Amy were here, say hi, Craig and Amy. So the first Sunday that they were here, they wanted to make an appointment to get together. They had a few questions. And so was it the very next morning, like Monday morning that we met? I think it was like the very next day. So we met at the Citrus Tower coffee shop, and they had some kind of event going on. So we actually went to the top of the Citrus Tower where you can have that beautiful view. And we sat up there for 3 hours. They had a laptop with questions, and they were taking notes. And now with them, it was like, these are things that we care about. These are things that are important to us. And we just sincerely are seeking information here and clarity. And it was a wonderful conversation. And they came back to church. So, it was a wonderful conversation. Questions are good when you're seeking information. This past week, Dave and I met with Ian one more time at that same coffee shop, actually. And, as they're getting ready to leave for the Navajo reservation. And Ian is one of these guys, and a lot of you are like this. And I just love it when we sit around and we just, you know, iron sharpens iron, man. You ask a tough question, just sit there and see where it goes. And he asked Dave and I a question that was a really, really good question. And I squirmed a little bit. I wasn't prepared. Like, could you email me that in advance the next time? But it was just something that was on his heart, something that he had been wrestling with. And so he asked us. I was like, man, I just felt so unprepared to answer that question. But it caused me to think a lot. And it was very helpful to me. And so you're going to hear a lot of questions today. And you can always answer out loud. We love that when that becomes part of our dialogue. But also, I just hope that internally that these questions take you on a personal journey. Here's my first question. Have we become a people who expect a big return for a small investment? Just kind of generally speaking in our nation, what are some examples of that? We expect a big return for a small investment.
Minimum wage.
Okay, so sometimes I want the wage to be less than minimum, but I want to do the minimum amount of work for it, right? I can definitely see that concept. Anybody else?
Walmart.
Walmart?
Walmart.
Okay, so I think you're supposed to say the Walmart, but that's okay. So what do you mean? You go to a place and what do you want?
You want the most for your money.
Okay, you want the most for your money, so you go to the Walmart. And you are looking for a great value at a low cost, right? We become a people that do that. We want a big return for a small investment. Some of the stuff I put here about my own self, you know, I want a healthy, delicious meal, but I want it really cheap and really quick, and I want to get it through the drive-thru. maybe you're somebody that wants to get the grade, wants to get the promotion, but like we said, you only want to do the minimum amount of work that's required, the absolute bare minimum. I want to learn to play guitar, but I only want to pick it up about once a week because, you know, I'm busy. I want to get in shape, but I only want to exercise when I really feel like it and it's convenient. I'd love to get rich, but I only want to make like a $2 investment at a gas station. We can become people who expect a big return on a very small investment. But more seriously is this, how am I investing in my spiritual growth? Scripture uses the word sanctification to talk about how we are on this journey to become more and more like Jesus, that we enter into salvation, but God's not done with us and he won't be done with us in this lifetime. We are continuing to be sanctified and we are growing more and more like Jesus. So how serious am I about investing in my spiritual growth and my sanctification? Am I seriously taking opportunities to invest in thinking about God and thinking about spiritual things? Am I investing in God's word by deeply reading and meditating scripture, not just going through the motions and not being quick about it? Am I praying and fasting? Am I serving? Am I sharing the good news of Jesus? And if your answer is, yeah, I do those things, but it's pretty much once a week on a Sunday morning, then you might be expecting God to bless you with big returns on a small investment. And I think this is so important because there is no such thing as winning the spiritual lottery. There is no get to be like Jesus quick scheme. But there's another important consideration here too. It's insulting to God when we invest the bare minimum, but we expect him to give us a great return on that investment. And so the big idea that's going to come out of this passage today is in the form of a question. The big idea is this: God's love for us is nothing less than wholehearted. God's love for us is nothing less than wholehearted. I couldn't think of a stronger word to use than wholehearted. So if you can think of a stronger one, write that in the margin of your journal here. God's love for us is nothing less than wholehearted. Are we returning his love with half-hearted devotion? Are we returning his love with half-hearted devotion? Our passage comes from Mark chapter 12, beginning in verse 28. This story is also told in Matthew 22, beginning in verse 37, and Luke 10, beginning in verse 27, if you'd like to jot those down as references as well. What we've seen here recently is the Pharisees and the Herodians and the Sadducees coming up to Jesus in public this last week of his life, kind of in the middle of the week, and asking him these questions where they think they're going to catch him. They think they're going to trap him. They think they're going to trip him up. And today we see a scribe come up and ask Jesus a question. Now, none of these guys have been asking Jesus questions because they're seeking truth or trying to gain any kind of knowledge. They're simply trying to get Jesus to say something in public that will get him in trouble with Rome. They're trying to ruin his credibility with the people. They're trying to turn the people against him. But today's situation, I think, is different with this scribe. The context of this story leads me to believe that this scribe is sincere in his question. And when you see the question that he asks Jesus and the way that Jesus responds to him and the conversation that follows that, I think that you'll agree. I think this guy was sincere. And in the end, he goes on to affirm Jesus as a great teacher of truth. He goes on to, I believe, lend credibility to Jesus' claim as the Messiah. And through all of this, Jesus teaches us a lesson about the most important command in all of Scripture. Finish this statement for me, okay? Our love for God can be seen in how we live our lives. Good.
Love each other.
How we love each other. Okay, Jesus said that, right? How we what?
Interact.
How we interact with other people. Somebody over here said something too. How we love others. Okay, good, good. And you're going to see that come out of this text today as well. Our love for God can be seen in how we love each other, how we interact with other people. All of these things are absolutely true. So number one, here's the first question that we're going to see kind of implied in this text, if you want to write it in your journal. Number one, how do we view the Old Testament law? How do we view the Old Testament law? Now, these scribes, and you're going to see a scribe come up to Jesus and ask a question, they were professional scholars. They specialized in the interpretation and the application of the Old Testament laws, the law of Moses, as well as all of the man-made regulations that have gone on for generations. They're experts at enforcing these laws. Now, Matthew, in his telling, he tells us this. After last week's text, where they asked Jesus a question about the resurrection, tried to trip him up, and Jesus answers their question extremely well. Matthew says that they gathered themselves. And so the religious leaders try to get Jesus, doesn't work, and so they gather themselves. It's almost like, huddle up, okay, you know, we got to figure this out, we got to think about this, we got to do a better job, come on, you can do it, come on, now let's get back in there. And somebody says, okay, I can do it, coach, put me in. And so the scribe goes over and asks Jesus a question, but I do think it's different with this guy. Even though he may have been put up to asking this question, probably was. I was pretty good at that in school. Do you ever do that? You think of something really funny to say, but instead of you saying it out loud, you whisper it to the guy beside of you? Because he can't hold it in. And then he says it, you get to laugh, and he gets yelled at. So I used to be really good at that. So this scribe may have been put up to asking this question, but that doesn't mean that he's not sincere. I really think that he was. So here's the text in Matthew 12:28. And one of the scribes, he came up. Remember, they were all gathered together, and there they are. And he came up, and he heard them disputing with one another. And seeing that Jesus answered them well, he asked Jesus, which commandment is the most important of all? Which commandment is the most important of all? Now, if he'd been put up to this question, and he might have been, the religious leaders were hoping that Jesus would answer in some way that would contradict the law of Moses, or at least neglect the law of Moses, right? If he says something different than what we have in the law of Moses, then, you know, he's a heretic. He thinks he's above the law, and we can turn the people against him. The people saw Moses as the greatest figure in all of the Old Testament, and that's understandable. Moses is the one that led them out of 400 years of captivity as they were slaves in Egypt. He led them through years of wandering, 40 years of wandering throughout the wilderness, and he led them right up to the front door of the promised land. Moses is the one that received the law from God and then brought it to the people. And Moses experienced God's glorious presence in a way that very few ever have. If you remember, after he spent time with God, his face would glow, and he would cover his face with a veil because it was freaking everybody out. The Bible says that God spoke to Moses face to face as with a friend. To them, nothing could be truer, nothing could be purer than that which God gave them through Moses. And if Jesus claims something else to be more important, then he's a heretic, and we can discredit him in front of the people. And even though this man may have been sincere, he might have been put up to asking the question, that's fine. But that's the importance that they had, the priority that they set on the Old Testament law. And it's important for us to understand that, to understand this question. So also something that's important for us today is, how do we today, on this side of the cross, see the Old Testament law? Well, I think to answer that question, a good place to start is, how do we view all of Scripture? I was looking back through our website while I was thinking about this, and I wanted to see, I believe that this was worded by Phil years before I came here, and it was in the What We Believe section on our website, and here's what it says about God's Word. It says, we believe the Bible is God's Word, complete and inerrant. That means without error. I know that you knew that, but I had to look it up. Completely without error in its original form. Consequently, we believe every account in the Bible is true and factual as it is written. So we believe that the Bible is without error. That's a pretty big claim. But let me tell you why we believe that. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 says, all Scripture is breathed out by God. It's inspired. It's breathed out by God. Yeah, it's without error because it came directly from God. And is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. The Bible also tells us in 2 Peter 1:21 that human authors were carried along by the Holy Spirit as they spoke for God. What a beautiful picture that is. It's the same word that you would use as a river would flow and maybe carry a log down the river, that the Holy Spirit carried them along, directed their ways as they spoke for God. That's how we view Scripture, but what about our understanding of the Old Testament law? When we think of the Old Testament law, we immediately think of the Ten Commandments, right? That's the first thing that we think of. Actually, it was more like 613 laws that were given through Moses by God, about 613. And one of the things that we know is that the law was given to Israel, to the nation of Israel, not to the church didn't exist yet, to the nation of Israel. And that's important in the context. Some of the laws revealed how to obey and please God, such as the Ten Commandments. Some laws show how to worship God and atone for sin, such as the sacrificial system. Some laws were intended to make Israel distinct from the other nations around them, such as their dietary laws and some of their clothing regulations and things like that. But one of the things that we learn in the New Testament on this side of the cross is that when Jesus died, he ended the necessity of the law to make us right with God. He brought us peace where we were in conflict with the law, 613 of them. I love the way that Galatians says this. In Galatians 3, 23 through 26, Paul's writing to the church, to Christians, and he says this. Now, before faith came, he's talking about Christ and faith in Christ as Messiah. Before faith came, we were held captive under the law. We were held captive. We were imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then, the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. So Christ came, we were under the law, enslaved to the law, but when Jesus came, now we can be justified by our faith in him. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. The guardian is the law. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through your faith. The purpose of the Old Testament law was to be a straight edge to show us how crooked we are. It was to make us right with God through obedience until Jesus Christ came and we could experience God's grace in its fullness. The purpose of the law was to convict us of our inability to be able to keep the law. 613 of them through Moses. And in that, it points us to our desperate need for a Savior. Lord, we can't keep the law. We can't even keep the 10, right? We can't keep the law. We can't be perfect in our obedience to you. We're in desperate need of being saved. So number two, the second question that we're going to see here implied in this text is, how did Jesus fulfill the law? How did Jesus fulfill the law? Jesus doesn't ignore the Old Testament law. He doesn't neglect Moses. Listen to the answer that Jesus gives about which command is the greatest. We're in verse 29. Jesus answered, "The most important is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your mind and with all of your strength." And I hope that that sounds familiar because it was the first song that you sang today. What a beautiful song that is. And then Jesus says, "You didn't ask me, but I'll tell you." And the second greatest commandment is like this. "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." And one of the things that you said is that we show our love for God in the way that we love and we treat each other. Jesus agrees with you, or you agree with Jesus is probably a more appropriate way to say that. Jesus, in answering this, was quoting from the law of Moses, from Deuteronomy and from Leviticus. And he was showing God's word is true as revealed by God and through the prophet Moses. And if these religious leaders asking this question, putting this scribe up to asking this question, if they had paid attention to the teachings of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount, they would have known that Jesus had already denied any intent to do away with the Old Testament. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 and 18, Jesus said this, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I didn't come to abolish it. I didn't come to do away with it. I didn't come to neglect it or ignore it. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. Everything in the Old Testament, everything in these laws were pointing to Jesus and his fulfillment of them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until it is all accomplished. That's kind of like saying punctuation. It's kind of like saying until every I is dotted and every T is crossed, every iota and every dot will not pass from the law until it's all accomplished. That's Jesus' view of the Old Testament law. He didn't ignore it. He didn't neglect it. He didn't come to abolish it. He came to fulfill it. And that's our view of the Old Testament. Now, there had always been a debate among the rabbis, among these religious leaders, about which commandment was the most important. So it was a great question to ask. And they really didn't have much agreement. Here's how they viewed the Old Testament law. 613 laws given through Moses. And so they divided all of those laws into two groups, 248 positive affirmations and 365 negative prohibitions. And then they divided them even further. They divided all of those laws into heavy laws that were absolutely binding and light laws that were more flexible as determined by them. Yeah. Now, they were never really able to agree on which laws are heavy and which ones are light. And so there was always this tension and always this conflict and always this question. But they did know that they could never perfectly keep the 613 laws. And so they focused on the ones that they deemed most important, the heavy laws. And they hoped that by focusing on the heavy laws, that they could satisfy God and earn his favor by being so good and so obedient, even though... were they obedient? Absolutely not. They failed miserably at keeping the law. And even this watered-down effort of obedience was an unbearable burden. They could never keep the law. So they narrowed the list even more. And eventually, they really just focused on their man-made traditions because that was going to be easier for them to observe than God's law. And Jesus, answering this most important question, he also points to his purpose of fulfilling the law. You know, obedience cannot be merely external. Well, I kept the law. I remembered the Sabbath. I loved my neighbor. I did these things. Obedience must be internal. It must be from the heart, and it must be motivated by faithful love for the one true God. God's wholehearted love for us is ultimately seen through Jesus, through his coming to this earth and his sacrifice when he died on the cross. And that wholehearted love for us, it demands our wholehearted devotion in return. I believe Dave read this in our worship time. We love because he first loved us. That's 1 John 4:19. And this love that Jesus refers to as the greatest of all commands, it is a love of intelligence and will and purpose and choice and sacrifice and obedience. And this love, it flows from an acknowledgement of who he is as the one true God. And Jesus makes it clear that this love is mustered up by everything within us, everything that we have. Our heart, that's the core of our identity. It's the source of our thoughts and our words and our actions. And our soul refers to our emotions, the place of grieving, the place of brokenness, as well as the place of joy and peace. Our mind embraces a person's will and their intentions and their purposes, and strength is referring to our physical energy. So now listen to this greatest commandment. Jesus said, "And you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your mind and with all of your strength." That is the first and the greatest, the most important commandment of all Scripture. Jesus actually said it sums up the law. Our love for God is an intelligent, emotional, willing, and active love. And Jesus tells us, when he tells us what the second greatest commandment is, I believe in this sequence, we're not able to love our neighbor as we love ourselves until we have learned to fully love God. But when we love God with everything that we have within us, we become capable of loving each other, seeing each other through God's loving eyes. And as Jesus fulfilled the Old Testament law, he points to our desperate need for him. Colossians 2, verses 11 through 15. It's a little bit of a lengthy passage. It's on the screen, but I want you to hear this whole thing in context because it's talking about the law and it's talking about Christ. It says, in him also you were circumcised, which is a way of saying that you entered into the law. You entered into this covenant of the law. But he says, under him, under Jesus also, you were circumcised with the circumcision made without hands. So this is something different. By putting off the body of the flesh, okay, definitely talking about something different from the Old Testament law. By the circumcision of Christ, by entering into a saving relationship with Jesus, by having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the powerful working of God who raised him from the dead. And you who were dead in your trespasses and in your uncircumcision of your flesh, you who were slaves to your sin because you can't keep the law, you're dead in your trespasses, God made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt. This is a legal phrase, by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. He's talking about the law. This Jesus set aside, nailing it to the cross. He disarmed the rulers and authorities, and he put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. So here's the third question that comes up from this text. How close are we to the kingdom? How close are we to the kingdom? Let me illustrate. In the big picture of things, I'm going to ask you a yes or no question here. Are you in Orlando right now? Are you in Orlando? Yes or no? Okay. Are you close to Orlando? Relatively speaking. Okay, so what you're saying is, you're close to Orlando, but you're not in Orlando. Is that what you're saying? So there's a difference, right? You're close, but not in. Listen to the conversation that continues in Mark 12. Now we're in verse 32. After Jesus answered from the law of Moses about the greatest commandment, loving God with everything that is within you and loving your neighbor as yourself, the scribe just, he can't contain himself. And the scribe said to Jesus, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one and that there is no other besides him. And to love him with all your heart and with all the understanding, with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is much more," he elaborates on Jesus' comment here, and he's right on. He says, "is much more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." This guy gets it. And when Jesus saw that he answered wisely, Jesus said to the scribe, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And after that, no one dared to ask him any more questions. No, I guess not. There will be more questions, but Jesus will be asking the questions and making the confrontations. So this scribe, I'm sure, shocked and disappointed all of the other religious leaders because he did the exact opposite of what they had hoped for and what they had intended. He actually goes on to affirm Jesus' answer as being correct and parallel with the law of Moses. The age-old debate about the greatest commandment is now settled. But I love that he elaborates on it. He says, "Yeah, Jesus, you're right, yeah, because internally, fully loving God and truly loving God is so much more important than the external going through the motions of any amount of sacrifices." And he gives credibility to Jesus' message and his claim as the Messiah. And Jesus recognizes the wisdom of this man's response. And he says, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." What an encouraging statement. What a heartbreaking statement. You're not there, but you're close. You're almost persuaded. Almost, but, you know that song? Almost, but lost. The kingdom of God, that's referring to the kingdom of heaven, same thing. It's referring to being in a relationship with God of salvation by submitting fully to the reign of God. And it's really hard to imagine, it's really difficult to imagine what it might look like today for people to be close, but not in the kingdom of God. For someone to be close, but not in a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. What might that look like for someone to be close, but not in? Anybody dare? While I wipe my forehead? I'm not even one of those shouting preachers. Yes? Okay.
Bring some comfort and some closeness to God. He's not influenced.
Okay. That's what it could look like. Anyone else? So I know this pulls at your heart when you think about this statement from Jesus. Man, you answered wisely. You're not far from the kingdom of God. It's encouraging. It's heartbreaking that you're not there, but it's encouraging that you're close. You know, somebody that's just a good person. Even somebody that goes to church. But they haven't fully submitted to God. Somebody that claims a relationship with Jesus, but they have not fully submitted to God because maybe they have prideful ambitions that are more important. They're seeking, you know, the treasures on earth rather than storing up for themselves treasures in heaven. Maybe someone that said a prayer, signed a card, raised a hand, but did not, you know, extend that to obedience to God by repenting of their sin and changing their life and being baptized into the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And Jesus goes on in other places to tell us that there are going to be a lot of people. He says many who are close, they're not far, but they're not in. In Matthew 7, 21 through 23, Jesus said, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, on the day of reckoning, the day of judgment, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do mighty works in your name? Jesus, look at all we did. We wore your name. We lifted up your name. We did all of these good things.' And Jesus said, 'Then will I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness.'" Friends, first, I pray that you recognize where you are. Are you close to the kingdom? Are you in the kingdom? I want to encourage you to pray for clarity, that God gives you clarity on where you are. Then you will be able to once in the kingdom, to lead others closer to the kingdom and into a relationship of salvation. God's love for us, God's love for you is wholehearted. And your devotion to him must be more than lip service. It must be more than just going through the motions. Jesus quoted this passage from Isaiah 29, verses 13 and 14. "And the Lord said, 'Because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me, and their fear of me is a commandment taught by men, therefore, behold, I will again do wonderful things with this people, with wonder upon wonder.'" He's saying, listen, they're going through the motions, they're worshiping, they're even doing these things the way that I said to do them. They're following the commands, but their hearts are far from me. And he says, I'm gonna do wonderful things. Now that word, I looked it up because I'm like, well, we want wonderful things, right? The word does mean marvelous and extraordinary things. But in the context, we see that it has a secondary meaning. It means hard and difficult things. God is gonna turn on these people that are, their hearts are so far from him, even though they're going through the motions. Listen to the way that the Message paraphrases this passage. "These people make a big show of saying the right thing, but their hearts aren't in it. Because they act like they're worshiping me, but they don't mean it, I'm going to step in and shock them awake, astonish them, stand them on their ears. The wise ones who had it all figured out will be exposed as fools. The smart people who thought they knew everything and how everything will turn out know nothing." God's love for you is wholehearted. And he accepts nothing less in return. This passage today reminds me of another time that a young man approached Jesus and asked a question. He's called the rich young ruler. He's probably a local synagogue leader. We read his story in Mark 10, verse 17. He came up to Jesus and he said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus went on to say, "Well, you know the Old Testament law. You know the laws of Moses, right? Honor your father and mother. Don't covet, don't steal." And this man answers, "Oh, yes, I know those. I've kept all of those since I was a young man." And then Jesus looked at him and he loved him. In verse 21, Jesus said, "You lack one thing. You lack one thing. You're not far from the kingdom. You're close, but you're not there, and you lack one thing." What was his one thing? Anybody remember? Yeah, Jesus said, "Your stuff is getting between you and God. You need to get rid of everything, sell it all, give it all to the poor, and then come and follow me." And the man walked away sad because he was very wealthy. There are a lot of similarities in these two accounts. Jesus said, "You lack one thing." Jesus said, "You're not far from the kingdom." A lot of similarities. Something that I see in both of them that I really want to challenge us with today. It seems that the closer you are to the kingdom, the less you realize that you're not there yet. I think that there is a familiarity and a comfort that comes from being close to spiritual things and hearing sermons and playing Christian music and wearing t-shirts and having bumper stickers that can make us feel like we're very close to God, but maybe our hearts are far from him, or maybe there's one thing that we lack. And so I ask you this morning, how close are you to the kingdom? Is there something holding you back from wholehearted devotion? The next step that I want to challenge you with today is this. To answer this question, what is one thing I lack? What is one thing that I lack? Is there a habitual sin that you've just not given up? An unrepentant heart, just a failure to submit to the reign of God, a lack of faith, a lack of trust, placing your confidence in yourself and your own abilities rather than in Jesus and what he accomplished on the cross. Is there one thing that you lack? I just want to encourage you to give God all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind, and all of your strength, and enter into the kingdom. Let's pray. Our Father, we love you and thank you for the love that you have for us. Lord, your love. The word wholehearted falls short, but your love for us is an amazing love. It is an all-encompassing love. You loved us so much that you sent your one and only Son to live among us, to teach us, to call us to repentance, and to die on the cross because we were unable to follow your law. Lord, help us to realize that, you know, when we're failing and when we're falling short of being fully and perfectly obedient to you, that that is just a reminder of how desperately we need Jesus. I pray that you would pull on our hearts today. And Lord, if there's one thing that is keeping any of us from being fully submitted and fully surrendered to you, Lord, I pray that we would be able to see that clearly in our minds, that you would give us clarity about that, and that we would be able to repent of that and to overcome that, not with our strength, but with yours. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
One of the things Frank asked us about or illustrated to us was this idea of kind of a conversational discussion about where we live. He asked about, you know, are we actually in Orlando? And as a means of conversational shorthand, sometimes when people don't know where our family lives, it's easier to say Orlando. Because people know where Orlando is, they're not sure where Groveland is. But if somebody's coming to visit us, we definitely want to make sure they know where we are. So we give them adequate directions. We don't say, oh, just come to Orlando and you'll find us. And I think there's a responsibility we have, not just to stay close to God, but to make sure others know who He is. And to praise Him and to live our lives in such a manner that causes people to recognize that the love of our heart, soul, mind, and strength is the Lord. I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at His right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take Him at His word indeed. Christ died to save me, this I read, and in my heart I find a need of Him to be my Savior, that He will leave His place on high and come for sinful men to die. You count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me breathe. My strength, my solace from the spring. That He who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior. That He would leave His place on high and come for sinful. Thank You for Your grace. We pray that we would be so willing to give our lives back to You. All of our heart, all of our soul, mind, and strength. And that we might show that to the world around us, that they might be drawn to You as well. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God. My Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be.
Savior loves, my Savior lives.
God, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We thank you for the blessings that we can share together as a church family. And now, Lord, as we come to the close of this time of corporate worship, where we come together, and corporate just sounds so odd to us, when we come together for a time of worship as a family, Lord, we know that our worship doesn't end. We know that praising you is not a Sunday morning activity. It's an everyday, every moment activity. Let us live our lives in such a way to bring such glory and honor to your name. Lord, we think about those in our church family that are not able to be here today. Think about our brother David Wood that took a bad fall this morning. And I just pray that he would heal. And thank you for Carla's love and compassion for him as she looks over him and watches him. Think about Sherry and Laverne that aren't able to be here with us today. We continue to pray for their health and for Miles. And I'm sure I'm leaving people out, Lord, but I just pray for those who are unable to be here today because of their health. But I also pray for those, Lord, that cannot be here today because of their hearts. Those ones that are close to the kingdom, but still not quite there. Those that sing songs of praise, they may even pray and participate in things, but Lord, their hearts aren't fully committed. Lord, I ask for your forgiveness in those times when I personally live such a life that would echo that same thought. But Lord, I pray for those today that don't have a close relationship. Maybe they even claim the name Christian. Maybe they would even say a church name that they're members of. But they are not fully invested into a relationship with you or to building up your kingdom. Draw them close to you, Lord, through your Spirit, through the encouragement of the church family, through the body of Christ, that we might restore those that need restoration, knowing the Lord, you give the spiritual restoration. Lord, we can restore relationships, but that we can also strengthen the body through unity and through a common goal of accomplishing your will in our lives and in the life of this church. And now, Lord, as we close, Lord, I pray that you would give us a wonderful time of fellowship, that if there are prayers that need to be offered, Lord, that we would seek each other out, that we would put an arm around each other, that we would hold hands in prayer together and pray over the needs that others might have, whether they are within this church family or connected to this church through relationships or conversations that have been held. Strengthen this church family, Lord, through your grace, through your mercy, and through the power of your Holy Spirit. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all.